It's something many people dream of doing, but frankly, pretty much no one has actually accomplished, and that is go to space. My next guest, though, has not only done it, he's gone on spacewalks, he's helped repair the Hubble telescope, he has seen our tiny, fragile planet from afar. Mike Massimino is a former astronaut, author of the new book, Spaceman, An Astronaut's Unlikely Journey to Unlock the Secrets of the Universe. It's your biography.
It is, memoir.
And this is something, you know, people say, do you just wake up one day and want to become an astronaut? For you, no, it was very, very early.
It was. When I was six, Neil Armstrong took those first steps on the moon, and that caught my attention. To build up to that, Erin, you know, those months before Apollo 10 flew close down to the surface but didn't land, and then Apollo 11, it was a huge buildup. There was everything, everybody was talking about it, and it really caught my attention, and it touched me in a way that was very unique. It really grabbed me down in my heart, down in my soul, and it never let go. And it got me at 6 years old, watching on the TV set, looking up at the moon at night from my front yard, knowing that there were people up there.
Wow.
It just struck me, this is the most important thing going on.
And you just knew from that age. I mean, you then aspired, you dreamed.
Well, I dreamed about it, but also reality kind of set in when I was about age eight, and I was like, I don't think this could happen. And it became an impossibility. You know, just to kind of cross it off the list along with cowboy and circus clown and whatever else you want to be when you're a little kid.
Yeah.
It's like, no, this will never happen. I can't do this. This is, you know, these guys are superheroes. They're, you know, it's not me. Impossible. And so, you know, I was a skinny kid who couldn't see very well, and I don't like heights. So I didn't think of myself as the astronaut profile.
So,
and I gave it up pretty much. I gave up that I'd dream until later.
All right. So then what happened? What made you circle back and achieve it?
After going to college, after I graduated Columbia with my engineering degree, I was working in Manhattan, moved back to Franklin Square where I grew up, was commuting into the city every day. And I just noticed things. Like, I noticed I would go by the Penn Station and see the newsstand, and if there was an article on the space program, the shuttle program began, it was in high gear pretty much then in the mid-80s, and I would see an article, I would grab the paper and I would read it. If I saw a magazine that had a space article, I would grab it. If there was something on television, a news program, if you were broadcasting back then with an astronaut or something about a space story, I would watch it, and nothing else mattered to me. And I started realizing maybe there's something there. And although I was never exposed to the space program, didn't think much about it, you know, there wasn't much going on in New York, where in my world,
right,
with the space program, it wasn't like Houston or some other place. It never left me. That little boy dream never left me. And I thought to myself, either I can continue to go by the newsstand and read about it, or, you know, watch reruns of The Right Stuff, or I could be a part of it. And I decided I needed to be a part of it. I didn't know if I could become an astronaut. I found out that was still impossible, pretty much, just the odds against that happening. But I felt like I could do something. I wanted to do something in the space program. And that's, I started taking those steps and went to graduate school and started applying and kept at it.
And you kept at it. And when you say the deck was stacked against you, I mean, first of all, that in and of itself, I think so few people, there's probably a lot of people out there who say, yeah, there's something in the newspaper I pick up and read. But to actually pursue it is so unusual. And then, you know, when you talk about your eyesight, I mean, you couldn't see very well.
No,
you were rejected.
Can. Yes.
And yet you still didn't give up.
Yeah, you know, the way I looked at it when that happened to me, when I was medically disqualified, I applied twice and was just rejected. The third time I was interviewed and went through the medical exams, still no guarantee of getting picked, of course, but they couldn't even consider me because I failed the eye test. And I thought to myself, what am I going to do now? You know, I'm still going to be alive. I'm going to have to live with the fact that, you know, I can't do this job. And that lasted maybe for a couple days of disappointment. And then I thought, well, maybe there's something I can do about it. And I started looking into what I could do about it. And at the time, there weren't many options. But one thing was I could go through some vision training. Now that has all changed. You can go through LASIK and procedures now that they accept.
You actually went through a vision training?
I went through vision training because I could not do anything. Yeah, they did not accept anything back then. This is over 20 years ago. So a lot of these procedures to improve your vision through an operation, they didn't accept. If you did that, you were disqualified forever. But when speaking to them, they said, well, this has never worked. No one's ever done this. I said, well, if I can somehow train myself to see better, would that be okay? And I'm like, if you can get yourself so you can sit there unaided acuity and read our eye chart and do our eye test, then okay. So I was like, okay. And I started training my eyeballs to see better.
What is it like in space? What was your first trip like?
It was really magical. It was wonderful. Everything was new, you know, right from the start.
What does it feel like when you are not in the cocoon of the space shuttle, right? When you're out, when you're doing that spacewalk, when there's Earth, and it's so tiny and fragile, and there's this inexplicable universe with whatever divine nature you believe it has, and then there's you.
Yeah, and especially the key word you picked up on there was being out on a spacewalk. Because inside the spacecraft, it almost seems half normal. You know, you can eat food when you want to, you can use the restroom, you're wearing kind of regular clothes, you know, a polo shirt or whatever, and you're looking out the window, kind of like being at an aquarium. Oh, look at the pretty fish I'm looking at. And then going out there as a spacewalker is kind of like being a scuba diver. Now, I felt like I was interacting with that environment. I really felt like a spaceman. You know, to use the title of the book, I really felt like a spaceman at that point. And you have the sense of that it's you in your own little spaceship, and that's what it is, interacting in that environment. And you can see our planet, and you can see the vastness of the universe. And one of the things that struck me, it was that it is so beautiful. It was like looking into heaven. It's a paradise. And then you can turn your head and look and see all of that, not darkness. I mean, it's beautiful out there, but there's nothing as beautiful as our planet for a long ways. And there may be life out there. I think there is. I think there's got to be. From what Hubble has shown us, all the possibilities for stars and planets around their stars, there has to be. We just found recently water on Europa, the possibility of life
even in our solar system, or maybe
somewhere we can go. So if you think of all those possibilities out there, the billions of possibilities, there's got to be somebody else. But I don't know if anyone has as nice a house as we have. I think our home, our Earth, I can't imagine any place being more beautiful.
Mike Massimino, thank you so much.
Erin, thank you for having me. It's great to be here. This is another one of those extraordinary experiences. Getting a chance to talk to you about it, and I appreciate the opportunity.
All right, thank you.
Pleasure.